Now that the wood beams are done on the diorama base, I go back to the Martian Invader once again. This time around, I need to do some major masking on both the arms and legs to prepare the body to have paint airbrushed on. Again, the masking is done so the paint overspray doesn't go on paint I've already applied and to give crisp, clean lines. After applying paint to the body, I return to the base to paint the Liberty Bell. Painting the Liberty Bell was a bit of a challenge because I needed to not only make a color that people who looked at the piece could relate to, but also give it a scorched metal look from being singed by fire. In order to paint the Liberty Bell, I had to mask off all the wood beams as they were very close, giving little room for painting. I go back to the human victim on the base and do detail painting on the gory, bloodied remains and any touch-up work, if necessary, everywhere else. Then I go back yet again to the Martian Invader and apply more masking and paint on various areas of the Martian Invader's suit. Now that both the gloves and boots are dry on the Martian Invader, I start masking around the top of the gloves and boots with Tamiya 6mm masking tape, then go over that tape with 3M blue painter's tape. To make the masking process go faster, I cut up some paper towel strips and wrap them around the gloves, boots, and air tank, covering them up with more blue painter's tape. I mix Createx Colors Reducer with Createx Colors Pearlized Green and proceed to airbrush the entire Martian Invader's environmental spacesuit. Giving the paint time to dry on the Martian Invader, I go back to the base. It's now time to paint the Liberty Bell. To do that, I have to mask everything around it so the overspray from the airbrush won't get on what I've already completed. Using 3M blue painter's tape and paper towels, I mask off all the wood beams like I did on the Martian Invader's boots and gloves. I also put some blue painter's tape on the elbow and arm of the human victim, as it lays directly on the edge of the Liberty Bell. I lay down a base coat of ComArt Dark Rust, following that up with a layer of Model Master Gold, then FolkArt Metallic Copper. I dry brush Model Master Gold over that to bring out more detail, and of course, it looks way too bright. To darken the Liberty Bell, I mix FolkArt Metallic Copper and Ceramcoat Black Green together. The color is now how I want it, but the Liberty Bell needs to look dirty and burned from being in a fire. I accomplish that by adding Ceramcoat Black to the base color that I just applied. I airbrush burn and dirt marks all over it to make it look like it's been through a disaster. I complete the Liberty Bell by painting the wood frame that it's connected to the same way that I painted the wood beams. I take the masking off and apply some more paint to clean up certain areas. Though, I believe there's something missing. Oh yes, the gore! Using Tamiya clear red acrylic paint and a traditional paintbrush, I paint all the areas where there's gore. I also decide to paint over all the lime green areas that I airbrushed, as I personally didn't like how the effect turned out. I add a few extra drops and streaks of blood in a few areas and finish the base by sealing most of it with Model Master Flat Lacquer and all the bloodied, gory areas with Model Master Gloss Lacquer. The base is now complete. The pearl green paint is dry on the Martian Invader, allowing me to move on to masking. I start masking around the tubes, chest plate, and shoulders, and follow that up with the rest of the body, along with the arms and legs. I airbrush Createx Wicked Black on the tubes, chest plate, shoulders, and the head as a base for the next color. Floquil Steel Blue. After the steel blue has dried, I mask off all those areas, leaving the double air tank exposed, ready to paint. With my airbrush, I apply Createx Wicked Black over the white base and follow that up with Model Master Silver over that. Once dry, I apply Createx Wicked Red, then Createx Wicked Pearl Red to give the metal a not of this world appearance. Now that the base is complete, it's time to work on finishing the Martian Invader. Since all major parts have been painted except the head, that's the next area we will go. The head and face pose quite a painting challenge because you could take it in any one of three directions. The first being a representation of the original trading cards. The second being the Tim Burton movie version. And the third version could be one of your own creation. I decided to try to do an even mix of the original trading card and Tim Burton movie versions. In my opinion, the original trading card version is a bit scary and the movie version gives the head more color than the trading card version. So I believe mixing the two, if done right, will give the head an alien look that won't be too drab, but just colorful enough to be pleasing to the eyes. Detailing the Martian Invader suit is next, along with the beginning stages of painting the ray gun. Prepping the clear dome to be attached to the inside of the neck area in the top part of the suit will follow. At this point of the build, a lot of the detail work becomes more prevalent the closer we get to the end. Now that the environmental suit and the air tank are painted, I go to what I consider the most challenging part to paint, the head. I airbrush on a base color of Com Art Flesh over the entire head. Follow that up, painting the face, Com Art Bone Flesh, the brain with Com Art Opaque Deep Red, and ending with Com Art Purple Flesh on the face. I dry brush Ceram Coat Yellow over the red base coat on the brain, along with Ceram Coat Ivory all over the face. I add Com Art Opaque Red inside the mouth and in between all the teeth. I end this stage of painting by adding a light wash of Com Art Brown all over the face and wipe away. By adding the wash, more detail comes out of the face, making the Martian Invader even more grotesque to look at. I end painting the head and the face by adding more ivory to the teeth and eyes, along with red pupils. I lightly airbrush Ceram Coat Violet, Yellow, and Green on various areas to give a mixed look between the original trading cards and the Tim Burton movie. Detailing on the brain and face are now complete. Looking at the Martian Invader's environmental suit, I thought something was missing. It seemed to be lacking detail. It was there, but not showing. I put some Com Art Transparent Black in a paint mixing palette and with a paintbrush, started to add washes into the ribbed areas, the gloves, and boots. Adding the washes really brought out the detail of the suit and also a dimension that would have been overlooked. I decided to airbrush a black base coat on the ray gun and let dry. I will get back to the gun soon. I wanted to give the look that the Martian Invader had been fired on by various weapons and that it walked through the fire of the building where the Liberty Bell was housed when the Martian destroyed it. I took some black pastel sticks and with a hobby knife shaved a good amount off, dipped a flat paintbrush into it, and dry brushed a black pastel all over the environmental suit. Now that I gave the Martian Invader a dirtier look, I seal the paint and pastels with Model Master Semi-Gloss Lacquer and let dry for 24 hours. I decided to add more black pastel to the air tank to give the illusion that fire wrapped around the back and the air tanks of the Martian Invader. I add Ceram Coat Ivory to the tips of the tentacles on the face, paint the earpieces with Flow Quill Steel Blue, and add black wash in the center ring. Lastly, I dirty up the upper chest plate with both Com Art Transparent Black and Black Pastel Chalk, adding Createx Wicked Red to both lights. With the black dry on the ray gun, I add a few light coats of silver and let dry. It's now time to attach the acrylic dome that goes over the Martian Invader's head. Like suggested with a sheet that's included with the statue, I warm up the plastic dome with a hairdryer so that it will be more flexible and easier to attach, so it can seed into the top of the environmental suit. Though, through much trial and error, I could not get it to fit properly. So much so, I ended up rubbing some paint off an area of the brain. I repainted the area of the brain and, using my motor tool, bored out around the inside of the environmental suit in hopes of making the dome fit properly. By doing that, I thinned out the front of the suit too much as I went right through. I take some AV's two-part epoxy sculpt, fill in the hole, sand, and repaint the area. By trying to force the acrylic dome in, it cracked. So I decided to go to one of my older Screamin' Models Mars Attacks vinyl model kits that I haven't put together yet and take its dome. I'll be able to replace that one without a problem. Sometimes you may be forced to compromise or think outside the box to get the job done. Nothing but detail work is in store for the last part of the build. Working on final paint and detailing of the ray gun is next. Attaching the new dome to the repaired Martian suit follows, along with constructing an original battery pack for the ray gun. Lastly, a newspaper will be created to scale to be added to the base. Remember, in the end, the model you work on is your own. Only you will know what's right and when it's truly complete. Try to be creative and think outside the box so that you can come up with something that could be slightly different and special compared to what you start with. Let's go to the last part of this lesson and finish the build. Getting back to the ray gun, over certain areas, I airbrush ComArt Transparent Ultramarine and ComArt Transparent Bright Red over the silver and let dry. I go back to the new dome that I acquired and test fit it. I'm able to flex it inside the suit by pressing down on top of it, making the bottom flare out. I add 5-minute two-part epoxy to the inside of where the dome seeds and hold it there until the glue hardens. Noticing there are gaps between the dome and the suit, I add tulip black fabric paint all the way around and let dry for 24 hours. After the paint is dry, I paint over it with FloQuil steel blue, shade it with black pastel chalk, and lightly airbrush ComArt opaque black around the base of the dome. I decide that I want to add more to the model to give it an original trading card look. So I decide to make a battery pack for the ray gun. I take weights used for Pinewood Derby cars, glue them together, place it where I want it on the statue, grind out two sections on the back to make it fit, paint it the same color as the suit, and attach it with 5-minute two-part epoxy. I touch up the paint, add a strip of styrene on each side to hide the sections that I cut out, and paint those along with adding a burnt shadow effect. The last thing that I need to do to the statue is address small details. On the ray gun, I wanted to give it a very worn and battered look. I achieved that by taking the pointed end of a nail and scraping the transparent paint away to reveal the silver paint underneath. Next, I drill out a hole in the handle of the gun and attach a rubber hose at the end and attach it to the battery pack that I scratch built. Lastly, I photocopy several sheets of a newspaper that's included with the old Screamin' Mars Attacks vinyl kit, burn it around the edges, and glue it under the foot of the Martian invader. I then add several drops of Tim Gore's blood red color on top of the newspaper to simulate splattered blood. That's it! The statue is fully painted and looks completely different from the pre-painted version that Quarantine Studio had released. Plus, I added a few other things to truly make this version a one of a kind. Remember, never be afraid to take away or add things to a model or statue. When you do that, it makes it something that becomes unique that no one else has. Hopefully, you've learned a little something that you will be able to use in your model building adventures.